presence of God is in this place. Our Episcopal leaders, Bishop and Mother Norris, our district leaders, Reverend and Mrs. Darby, we acknowledge Sister Donna Bannon. Oh, I drag that woman all over the place this week. She just kept going. I think she was probably ready to throw me away a little bit yesterday, but she just kept checking the wrong shoes on. She just kept on going. Thank God for her. Reverend and Brother Kitty, Sister Willie Ann Hamilton, to Brother Gilliard and his board, Brother Moon and his board, to Sister Butler and his music ministry.
Yes, but they don't know.
see that Ezekiel started out in a little area that was a real haven for Jews. Reminded me of my military experience. Every time we would go to a port, right outside of that port would be a little space they call A-Town. American town. Military people know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
You could buy a hot dog in A-Town.
Amen.
You could hear James Brown in A-Town.
Amen.
You got a little taste of America in A-Town.
Amen.
And outside of every old base, somebody would decide to set up a little A-Town.
Yes.
American town. You know, and it's the same way in the United States. We lived in Chicago. If you drive down Michigan Avenue from Chicago to Evanston, where we actually lived, Evanston, Northwestern University, you'd go through the Hispanic community, and then you go through the Jewish community, and then you go through the Greek community, and then you go through the Ethiopian community, and then you went through the Middle Eastern community, and all these little communities that captured their culture and held it tight.
Yeah.
That's where Ezekiel lived. This week we took the Gullah Geechee tour. And while we were on the Gullah Geechee tour, they told us that along the Geechee Corridor, 30 miles from the coast, from North Carolina down into Florida, along that section, people were able to preserve their African heritage better than any other part of the country.
Amen.
How many of y'all had righteousness? Nobody ain't Rochester Day. Raise your hand. You know why you had Rochester Day? Because the Gullah Geechee culture preserved that. That's from the rice cultures in Africa, West Africa. You thought you had rice because you wanted to. You had, and yesterday we had red rice. Now that I had red, you know why? It was preserved. And it's important to understand that this man Ezekiel is living in this area where much was preserved. He was able to eat kosher food. He was able to worship in his own way. He was able to hear the old prayers. He was able to sing the old songs. He lived where people looked like him and acted like him. And they were able to preserve much of their culture even though they were in captivity. They were teachers. And they were able to even use their own language and put their words into the language of dominant culture. But God said, I got a mission for you.
Yeah.
I want you to go down to Tel Aviv. And when you go down there, I want you to sit with the people down there, because they're sure enough really in captivity.
Yeah.
See, they can't retrace their roots. They don't remember how to worship correctly.
Yeah.
And try to figure out what was going on for Ezekiel as he Point three. Ezekiel was amazed. Because after he said, or they said, he began to understand.
Amen.
When he first got there, his little judgment finger was out and said, look at all the sin they're committing. And then he began to experience their pain, and that softened his heart. And then he sat where they sat, and he began to understand. You know, so many times we judge a person, but we haven't sat where they sat. And we don't understand. Some brothers in the church and don't even know the order of service says he ought to sit down, but he's still in the back, and he's still praising God, and he's still thinking, Lord, if we sit there, they sit down, brother, you're out of order. But you don't know what he went through. You don't know where God brought him. You don't know what he experienced until you sit where he sat. He was betrayed by a friend. He said, Drive by
teen and thrive. And we appreciate you because of your gratefulness to God. And says that, what shall I render for all your benefits towards me? And our pastor always talking about how he is favored by God. God has favored him, and because of that, he will feed us, and he always does. Our drive-by number three, because of your work, and that comes from Galatians 6 and 9, we say to you, don't be weary with us. Don't be weary in good doing, because in due season you will reap if you faint not. So God has given you shepherds so that you can watch over and on behalf of all of us. We're going to drive past you, and we're going to call Sister Donna forward. And Sister Bubba is going to sing a salute to both of you. Amen.
Thank you.
chocolate. Thank you, one and all. You have been so kind to us. It's only been about 5 or 6 months, but we feel like we've known you all our lives. You have grown awesome. Thank you. I'm all alone, but I'd be mad if the bishop didn't send me back next time. We're going to do reading 800. And we'll take the time out of the fellowship time. So you're not staying any later. We'll take it out of the fellowship time. Christ is the head, and that it is the design of the gospel to bring together in one all who are Christ's. The fellowship of the church is the communion that his members enjoy one with another. The end of this fellowship, the maintenance of sound doctrine, and the ordinances of that power, godly admonition and discipline which Christ has committed to his church, is for the promotion of holiness. It is the duty of all persons to unite in this fellowship, for it is only those, the planted in the house of the Lord, that will flourish in the courts of our God. Its more peculiar duties are to promote peace and unity, to bear one another's burdens, to prevent each other's stumblings, to seek the intimacy of a friendly society among themselves, to continue steadfast in the faith and worship of the gospel, and to pray and sympathize with each other. Among its privileges are peculiar incitements to holiness from the hearing of God's word, sharing God's ordinances, placing persons under the watchful care of pastors, and the enjoyment of the blessings which are promised only to those who are of the household of faith. Into this holy fellowship, these persons before you, who have already received the sacrament of baptism, come seeking admission. We now purpose, in the fear of God, to question these persons as to their faith and purpose, that we may know that they are proper persons to be admitted into the church of God. Okay, y'all, two proper people here. Dear love, you are seeking that great privilege of a union with the church which our Savior has purchased with his own blood. We rejoice in the grace of God given unto you, in that he has called you to be his followers. You have heard how blessed are the privileges and how solemn are the duties of membership in Christ's church. And before you are fully admitted, it is proper that you do here publicly renew your vows, confess your faith, and declare your purpose by answering the following questions. Do you here in the presence of God in this congregation renew the solemn promise contained in the baptismal covenant, ratifying and confirming the same, and acknowledging yourselves bound to observe and keep that covenant and all things contained therein? Have you saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you possess friendly feelings toward all the members of this church? Do you believe in the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, Holy Scriptures, as set forth in the Articles of Religion of the African Methodist Episcopal Church? Will you be governed by the discipline of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, hold sacred the ordinances of God, and try as much as possible to promote the welfare of fellow members and the advancement of God's kingdom? Will you give your time, talent, and money for the support of the gospel, church, poor, and various ministries of the church? This is like the wedding vow. Is there any reason why these persons should not be received into full membership? You now speak or forever remain silent. I hear none. Amen. Grab your right hand. We cordially welcome you into the fellowship of the Church of God, and in light of our Christian love, I extend unto you the right hand of fellowship, and may God grant that you may be a faithful member and useful member of the church militant, until you are called to the fellowship of the church triumphant, which is faultless in the presence of God. And the church said, Amen. We cordially welcome you into the fellowship of the church of God, and in light of Christian love, I extend unto you the right hand of fellowship, and may God grant that you may be a faithful and useful member of the church militant, to your call to the fellowship of the church triumphant, which is faultless before the presence of God. And the church said, Amen. We're going to now fellowship our two new members. I'm going to ask that the steward board stand surrogate for the entire church. Can we do that? Amen. So stewards, if you'll greet our new members.
Yeah.
we ask a blessing on our time of fellowship, that all that we do bring you glory. Bless the food we're about to receive, that it may be nourishment for our bodies. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Fellowship hall. I won't shake your hands at the door. I'll meet you in the fellowship hall.